or single or divorced or widowed or dating or searching, or if your Facebook status says complicated. I'm praying that all of us will hear from God some great stuff this morning that we can, you know, that we can maybe download into our hearts and minds that will have a profound impact on all of our relationships. So let's jump into this morning. You know, Kim and I have been married, this year will be 39 years. 39 years, yeah. We got married when we were 6, and we're from Mulberry, so that's normal. It's kind of normal. Actually, we met in church. It's a good place to meet, right? When we were in the 5th grade, we met in church and dated in high school and college. And so we've been learning to love each other for all these years, trying to love each other like God loves. And we have a great marriage, but like all marriages, there can be challenges. I mean, just think about it. Take two imperfect people with different personalities, different physical and emotional needs, different family of origin issues, different strengths, right? Different weaknesses, different goals and expectations. And then we try to blend them into this happily ever after blissful experience. And about 3 months into the marriage, we say, you know, why can't you be normal? Why can't you be like me, right? Because if you just acted like I act and communicated, I don't need to point to her when I say this, right? This is for all of us. If you could just communicate like me, I hate these messages. I really do. If you could just communicate like me and, you know, like the same movies and food, then our relationship would be awesome. And whenever I find my mind kind of going there, I hear self say, seriously, Monty? You would really want to live with something exactly like you? No. I mean, ask him sometimes. You don't even really have to ask her. You know it because you know me. I can be so selfish. Everything has to be about me. And sometimes we're both kind of left asking the question as we've said things to each other, where does that come from? Where did that come from? And I think every married person has asked that question of the other person many times, probably throughout your marriage. Well, I've got good news for you. Good news for us today. I'm going to explain for you all the vast complexities and nuances of marital conflict, and I'm going to solve all of our problems today. Amen. Amen. Are you ready?
Yes.
All right. Okay, I'm going to start with this illustration right here that I saw a long time ago, and it's kind of difficult to follow, so just try to stick with me, all right? Just try to stick with me. Y'all see this over there? This is Mr. and Mrs. Mugg, and Mr. and Mrs. Mugg met in a kind of a traditional way. They met in college. They were at a college party one night, and Mr. Mugg saw Mrs. Mugg standing over there. Her name wasn't Mrs. Mugg then, it was probably Miss Cup or something like that. Miss Cup. He saw her over there, you know, he was attracted, and you know, it took him for like 30 minutes to make his way over there. That's how we guys are, you know. Mr. Muggs was no different, right? He struggled to get over there, but he finally did, and he got over there, and he began to talk to Miss Mugg and Miss Cup, whatever, hang with me, it's my illustration. And turn these guys this way just so. And they began to talk, and she gave him her number, and he called her later on and asked her out for a date, and she said yes, and they were so excited, you know, and so they wanted to put their best foot forward, and so he put on a clean shirt that his mom had washed about a weekend ago when he went home, took all of his laundry home to her. She had washed he put on deodorant, and she fixed her hair and got dressed so nice. And he had saved up some money because he really wanted to take her somewhere really nice. And so they went to Outback Steakhouse, and that's really nice, isn't it? Yeah. And he was so worried that she was going to want to order everything on the menu and that he would be kind of relegated to eating that brown bread, you know, that's all he would have. And sure enough, she looked at the menu and she really wanted a steak and a blooming onion. But then she said, well, maybe I'll just order a salad. And he was so relieved, right? So relieved. But they really enjoyed each other and they made effort to take care of each other and they just began to date. And, you know, they would go to the movies, usually a movie that she picked out. Right, and she would say, oh, wasn't that such a great movie? And he'd go, oh, yeah, it was awesome. Sorry to break that to you, ladies. But. And then she would go with him to his intramural basketball games on campus at midnight, right? And she would, you know, she would cheer for him and, you know, his greatest cheerleader and just encourage him. She goes, oh, my goodness, I don't know why they don't give you a scholarship to play on the basketball team. You're so good, sweetheart. It's awesome. You're awesome. And they just continue to engage and, you know, want to take care of each other. And so eventually they got engaged and they got married and they went on their honeymoon and came back. And, you know, after a while they're living there in their apartment. And one day she comes home from work and she walks in and he's playing video games with his buddy and trouble there, right? And she notices that he hasn't done anything she's asking to do. You know, like put the dishes away, clean the dishes, put them away, right? Or fold the laundry, put the laundry away. She'd ask him to do those things. So she just kind of filed that into her head there. And after his buddy finally left later on that night, she just kind of went off on him. She said, I can't believe you didn't do what I asked you to do. That was a little hard, but, you know. At least you could have done was put up the laundry, you know, and put it away so it wouldn't look like a mess. And he goes, well, I didn't know you wanted me to do it right now, today, you know, before you got home. And they just begin to have this, and, you know, and they begin to say things like, you never and you always and all that kind of stuff, right? And then all of a sudden they would just stop and they'd look around and go, where did this come from? Where did this come from? But it began to kind of become a pattern in their relationship where they, every once in a while she would explode or he would explode with words that, you know, that would hurt and they just kind of continued to do that. And one day she finally just got so frustrated that she went her way, he went his way, and she went to her mother's house and she began, and her sister was there and her mother said, well, I could have told you this before. And, you know, I tried to tell you that he wasn't going to change when you got married. You know, I tried to, you wouldn't listen to me. And his sister said, wow, he needs a therapist. You need to get counseling for him. And so then the guy went, well, we don't know where guys go, right? He went to Buffalo Wild Wings, had some chicken wings, watched football, didn't talk to anybody. And so they came back, and she had some ammunition, right? And she said, you know, my mom said that you would never change. And my sister said that you need counseling. And he goes, your mom's been married 3 times, and your sister can't even get a date. Why would you talk to them? And they would look around, and they would see that, wow, you know, where did this come from? Where did this come from? Now, here's the thing, okay? So this is super complex. So I want you to get out something to write down and to write on and put your thinking caps on. And so the reason that when they entered into the conflict and this came out of her mouth and, you know, this came out of his mouth, the reason for that, are you ready for this? Because that's what's in there. That's it. Write that down. This is what is in there. There's actually nothing else that could happen other than that, because that is what is in there. And I really don't want you to just take my word for it. I want you to look at how Jesus explained this. He said in Luke 6:45, he said, out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. Out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. And so the problem is not out there. The problem is in here. And all the pain points that that maybe we're currently walking through in our lives, in our culture, in our country, all of them really lead back to individual human hearts. Let me be a little bit more specific. It doesn't lead back to even institutions or structures or groups or all those things, you know, while they may produce problems, it initially comes from our individual hearts. The Bible says it this way. It says in Jeremiah 17:9, it says, "The heart is deceitful above all things and beyond cure. Who can understand it?" So with that said, let's kind of dial this into marriage. And let's set it up this way. The condition of your heart will determine the condition of your marriage. The condition of your heart will determine the condition of your marriage. And I can see, you know, there's a whole bunch of you that are going, "I hope he's listening to this, you know, or I hope she's listening to this." And you know, maybe she's kind of going, "You listening to this?" Or maybe even you're saying, "Oh, I hope they're online listening to this." Listen, I didn't say the condition of their heart will determine the condition of your marriage. I didn't say the condition of his heart or her heart. I said the condition of what? Your heart. The condition of your heart will determine the condition of your marriage. But here's the problem. We have sinful hearts. And when we have sinful hearts, we don't like to look at them, right? We would much rather look outside and blame, you know, collectively as, you know, it's that out there, as opposed to taking responsibility individually. And really, that's because of the sinful condition of our hearts. But here's the reality. You can't control his heart. You can't fix her heart. His heart needs a surgical procedure that cannot, you know, that you cannot perform. And if you try to fix your marriage without addressing the issues of your own heart, it's not going to work. But thankfully, the great physician, our God, is far more qualified than us to address the deep sickness of our hearts. And he makes a promise in his word. He says this in Ezekiel 36. He says, "I will give you a new heart, and I will put a new spirit in you. I will remove from you your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh." So I need to tell you today, if you have not surrendered yourself, heart, soul, mind, and strength to the great physician, to God's grace and his transforming work in your life, I love you enough to tell you, you are destined to spend your life frustrated and in pain and in grief, which means this is the best thing that you could ever do for your spouse. This is the best thing that you could ever do for your family, for your community. It's to surrender your heart over to him. Listen, surrender your heart over to the only one who can heal it. Now, with that being said, just because two people are followers of Jesus and they've had the power of sin removed from their hearts does not mean that they don't still experience the presence of sin in their lives. I mean, let's be honest, marriage can be a struggle. Right, I mean, the struggle is real, and in my perspective on marriage is actually that marriage is pretty simple, but that doesn't mean it's easy. Marriage requires something of us, by definition, that can only come through a new heart, provided by our Creator, that submits to God's authority in our life. And many of us, when we become followers of Jesus, instead of living our lives in joyful submission to his authority, and instead of embracing what he says is right and good and true and beautiful, we actually live our lives in rebellious resistance to those things. And then we wonder why things just fall apart. Take me, for instance. Again, I am by nature selfish. Everything, you know, has to kind of circle around me. Not all the time, right? But whenever I fall into that, you know, to that sinful flesh side, that's what comes out. I'm selfish, you know. When I'm in that state, my favorite song is Toby Keith's song, I Want to Talk About Me, I Want to Talk About I Want to Talk About Number One, Oh Me, Oh My, right? I want to talk about what I think, what I like, what I know, what I want, what I see. And my favorite movie character during those times is the seagulls in Nemo. You know what they do? Mine. I think we all have that tendency, don't we? I mean, it's a good day. It's a good day when I come off the throne of my life and let God be God. My favorite passage in all the New Testament is Philippians 2, because Philippians 2 kind of shows us a picture of how we need to live in relationship. It gives us this picture of, you know, having the attitude and the mindset of Jesus Christ. And let me just read it to you. It's Philippians 2, starting in verse 3, it says, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking out for your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others. In your relationships with one another, have the same, and here it is, have the same mindset, attitude as Christ Jesus. And here's what that mindset looks like. Who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. It says in one translation, not to be grasped by him and held on to him. Rather, he opened up his hand and made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, and being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. And we need to ask God to give us that kind of heart, that kind of mindset, where we're willing to open up our hand and let go of our privileges, you know, our rights. You know, we do have those things, but he says, no, you got to open those up and be for the other person. You got to have this humble servant's heart, where you're putting their needs above your own in every situation. You've got to have this obedient will that's willing, Monty, to die to self and sin and stuff. I mean, we don't have to be crucified on a cross, but we do need to die to the crosses in our own lives. And we know what they are, right? We needed to die to that stuff daily so that Christ can begin to live through us with a new heart, a new mindset, the mind and attitude of Christ. Here's what I know. Our view of marriage has been shaped more by culture than the cross. Our culture influenced our view of marriage far more than the cross. And the big picture that's being painted for us by Jesus on the cross is a picture that I think you could just title self-sacrifice. That's what marriage is. I think marriage can be captured, you know, as self-sacrifice, but also can be captured with this phrase, my life for yours. My life for yours. Which is precisely the opposite, by the way, of the perspective of our culture. I mean, the take on marriages from our culture is this, your life for mine. And the second that you don't fulfill me, the second that you don't satisfy me, do what I want you to do when I want you to do it, I'll find someone who will. Your life for mine. So because of the presence of sin in our lives, self-sacrifice doesn't come naturally to us. It only comes through the grace-saturated heart and the transforming work of Jesus. You see, faithfulness doesn't come naturally to us. It only comes through the faithfulness of God's kind hand working in our lives. And the part that we get to play is we get to walk hand in hand together with Him. And as He works on our hearts individually, we can become more and more like Christ, begin to have His mindset more and more when it comes to our relationships, especially our marriage. And as He does that, corporately as a church, we get to come together and we get to help one another. In other words, we get to supplement what God is supplying in each of our lives. We get to do this journey together. So let me talk about some of the ways that we want to come alongside of you and come alongside of each other. We've always done this, but even more, I want to, make sure that we are giving the right resources and energy to supplement what God is doing in your life and in your relationships, really, especially as it pertains to marriage and families this year. Let me just share this with you. I'm involved in a Tuesday morning men's Bible study every Tuesday morning at 6:30 to 7:30 with some real men that talk about real truth in ways really without pulling punches, and it's been so beneficial to me. I mean, I just sit there and I get to join in conversation around God's Word with a group of men that are struggling in the same ways that I am struggling. And we meet every Tuesday. And I just want to encourage you, if you're a man and you have that hour available, or if you can somehow make that hour available, I would say you need to be there. You need to be there. You know, our women have a Thursday morning Bible study. And if that fits your schedule, I would encourage you to be there and come alongside other women and grow in your relationship with God so His love, it would begin to pour out of you into your relationships, especially your marriage. Every year we have a marriage conference, and I'm going to give you a lot of notice. We're going to have another one in September, and I want you just to begin to think about that and say, okay, I'm going to make effort to be there. I'm going to make effort to be there. I'm going to begin to fight for my marriage and do everything I can to be a part of Bible studies, or our adult group, our discipleship group, to be a part of other men and women growing in our relationship with God. And as you're thinking about that, go ahead and circle this day. Go ahead and circle every Sunday. Every Sunday. Here's why. The statistics bear out that there are two things that are presently consistent in the life of every growing follower of Jesus. Read the Bible daily. Go to church weekly. I mean, it's not rocket science. It's pretty simple. And ultimately, this is about you and Jesus. It's not her and Jesus. It's not him and Jesus. It's you and Jesus. And when you surrender all of you to the transforming power of God's Spirit, He begins to produce stuff in you, like we talked about last week. As we begin to abide in Him and He abiding in us, He begins to produce stuff like love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and goodness and gentleness and faithfulness and self-control. He begins to produce that fruit in us. And so when that begins to happen, you begin to start looking a whole lot like Jesus. You're still uniquely you, but you become God's best version of uniquely you. John Ortberg says, as God starts moving in your life and doing His transforming work, you don't just start becoming holier, you also become you-ier. You become God's best version of uniquely you. And that's what I need to do. I need to bring the best version of me into our marriage, to my relationships. And the only way I can do that is to get my relationship with God right. I've got to let God begin to fill my deepest need. Nothing else can do that. Not even Kim. I've shared this before. It's kind of an old example, and probably 3/4 of you don't even remember, but that, you know, there was a movie called Jerry Maguire. I don't recommend the movie. But, you know, it's a love story, a chick flick. And he's in, you know, he's this NFL agent, and, you know, all of them are saying, show me the money, right? And he gets into a relationship with this woman, and they fall in love, and then they have a little issue, and she comes to him and she begins to, you know, kind of talk to him about, you know, how much she loves him, and he says, whoa, stop. He says, you had me at hello. And then the famous quote in all the movie is, you complete me. And all the girls and women go, oh, my goodness, you complete me. Tom Hanks completes me. No. Right? Who? Cruise, my bad. Yeah, Tom Hanks wouldn't woo anybody, would he, right? Tom Cruise. Well, some people have watched the movie, I guess, right? And so, you know, I begin to think about it. You complete me? Listen, Kim is my everything, right? She's my best friend. I love her passion for life. I'd rather be with her than anybody else. But she doesn't complete me. And I don't complete her. Only God. Only God can fill this God-shaped hole that we have in our hearts, right? It's in Christ. It's in Christ that we're made complete. And when we get that relationship right, then we can bring a better person to all of our relationships. Proverbs 19:22 says, what a person desires is unfailing love. You know, and sometimes we try to find that in a marriage or in relationships, you know, this love. No, what we really desire in the depths of our heart is unfailing love. And the only one that can do that for us and give that to us is our God. The only place that you can get that kind of love is that you have to go to the source of love. To hope or expect another imperfect person to complete you is setting up the relationship for a huge disappointment. Only when you love God and let God love you, only when you experience His unfailing love, will you be able to love in a way that a marriage needs. Brendan Manning says this, he says, if we want to truly love, one must return again and again and again to the great love of the great lover. You know, in Psalms, 40 different times, unfailing love is mentioned, and it's always connected to God. Psalms 32:10 says, many are the woes of the wicked, but the Lord's unfailing love surrounds the one who trusts in Him. Psalms 33:5 says, the Lord loves righteousness and justice. The earth is full of His unfailing love. Psalms 36:7 says, how priceless is Your unfailing love, O God. People take refuge in the shadow of Your wings. Psalms 17:7 says, show me the wonders of Your unfailing love. You who save by Your right hand and those who take refuge in You from their foes. Keep me as the apple of Your eye. Hide me in the shadow of Your wings. We all long for His unfailing love, one that is constant, compassionate, understanding of our faults, one that knows all about our flip side or our dark side or our weaknesses, but is still faithful and loves us anyway. The only place to get that kind of love is in a relationship with Jesus Christ. Letting Him complete me. Letting Him complete you. Letting Him in my life, letting Him love me has really changed everything for me, including my marriage. This scripture kind of helped me to relax in who I am. It's kind of helped me to find myself, my true identity as a treasured child of the Most High God. It's Ephesians 3:16-19. It says this, I pray that from His glorious unlimited resources, He will empower you with inner strength through His Spirit. Then Christ will make His home in your hearts as you trust in Him. Your roots will grow down into God's love and keep you strong. And may you have the power to understand, as all God's people should, how wide, how long, how high, and how deep His love is. May you experience the love of Christ, though it is too great to understand fully. Then you will be made complete with all of His fullness of life and the power that comes from God. That's my prayer. That's my prayer for you guys, that you would grasp how God sees and loves you. It's the most important thing you can do for your marriage, or really for any of your relationships, for your life. To grasp how big and wide and long and high and deep His unfailing love is for you. To let that love capture your heart, and to let that truth go all the way through you, so that you can learn to love and thrive in relationship with God and with other people. And when you do that, you will no longer say, "Why aren't you normal like me?" You will no longer say, "Where did this come from?" Because you will bring a better, a more humble you to the relationship. And if you do that, you can have the best marriage possible. I'm going to do something a little different today as we close. And so let me just do this, all right? It might be a little awkward, but let me just do this. Let me ask all the boys and all the men to please stand, if you would. All the boys, young men and men, all of us to please stand. And I want you to just kind of look up here, look at me in the eye. I know you don't like eye contact, right? But just look at me. Listen, I know for some of you that your heart's been wounded. I know that you've experienced pain or hurt, you've been discouraged, you've sometimes felt like a failure. I know that about you. But I also know this. I just know that if you have Jesus, you have everything you need. You have everything to be a good man, a godly man. You have everything you need to be a faithful husband, a strong and kind, godly father. Everything that you need to be a provider and a protector. If you have Jesus, you have everything you need. And it starts with your heart. Let me just ask the ladies and the girls to stand. Men, you stay standing. Men, you stay standing. We always want to sit down. Ladies, I know that some of you have had your heart hurt and broken. I know that some of you have even been abused and have suffered pain, and I know that some of you have suffered loss and disappointment and discouragement and anxieties. But I just know this. I know this. If you have Jesus, you have everything you need. If you have Jesus, you have everything you need to be a good woman, a godly young woman. If you have Jesus, you have everything you need to be a responsive wife, a nurturing, godly mother, a guardian of your family. If you have Jesus, you have everything that you need. And that begins with your heart. And so as we stay standing, You know, maybe if you're kind of wired like me, you'd look around, you know, you look at the condition of our world, and you're saying, okay, I want to do something about this, right? I want to storm the gates of hell. You want to do something revolutionary. Well, here's where it starts. Bow down to King Jesus. Submit your life to His authority. Establish a family. Build a home. And then draw a line in the sand and put a stake in it in the ground and say this, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. And then do it. Do it. And by the amazing grace of our God, He'll be there with you, fighting with you, helping you to grow, filling you with His fruit, producing it in your life so that your relationships, especially your marriage, can thrive. Not just survive, not crumble, but can really thrive. It begins with our heart. Surrender to Him. Pray with me, please. Father, I just thank You for Your word this morning. I thank You for Your presence here. God, I thank You that You are a God that created us and wants so much to be in a personal, forever relationship with us. God, that You want our heart totally and completely surrendered to You. Father, would you give us the strength, the courage, just to say yes to You? Jesus, we need You. God, help us to understand that this relationship begins with our heart. That, Father, we have to totally and completely come off the throne of our lives and allow You to become the King, the Lord of our lives, so that we can experience Your transforming work in our lives, God. That You can give us that new heart so that You can begin to mold it, shape it, transform it, so that we can become more and more like Jesus. And Father, help us to understand that it begins with the surrender of our heart. Father, I pray that, God, if anyone in here has never done that, has never said, here's my heart, God, I receive Your grace and Your forgiveness and Your mercy, God, I pray that You would give them and that You would speak into their heart and Your spirit would draw their spirit right now, Father, into a personal, forever relationship with You. Father, right now in this place, give them the courage to confess with their mouth that they want You to be their Lord. And that, Father, to believe in the depths of their heart that they need Jesus. The forgiveness that comes from Him being willing to sacrifice His life on a cross, to put our needs before His very own needs. So may we say yes to that grace and to that mercy. Right now where you are, just say, come, Lord Jesus. Be my Lord. Be my Savior. I pray that every one of us in this room, beginning with me, oh God, that we would surrender to You our whole heart, completely. So much so, God, that when You look back and forth across this room and across our lives and look into the depths of our heart, Father, that You see a heart that is totally surrendered to You. And Father, when You see that heart, You begin to strengthen it. Continue to transform it. So God, help us to have the attitude of Jesus. An open-handed attitude, a humble heart, an obedient will. We need you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. As we enter into this moment, let me encourage you just not to run out the doors. It's early still, right? Just continue to be still in the presence of your God. And just have the courage to respond to Him. Whatever that is that He's pulling in on your heart, the heartstrings of your heart right now, whatever that is, whatever decision that you need to make, He would give you the courage to say yes and to do it, step out in faith. And just surrender to the us that He wants us to be, that He's calling us to be. So if you need prayer, this altar is open to you this morning for prayer. If you need to come to one of us here standing down front to say, hey, this is the decision I need to make, or will you help me with this decision? You come. You decide. You respond. Say yes. So as we sing, you respond.
Mercy.
Pray with me, please. Father, thank you for being a God that makes all things new. God, and you begin with our individual hearts. And so, God, let us be a people that maybe if we don't understand you completely, even now, Father, that we're still willing to say, make me brand new. Begin to make me new in my relationships, my marriage, my family. Oh, God, begin to produce your fruit in our lives. And that, God, as it is produced, that it would pour up out of us and that love and that joy and that peace and that patience, that self-control, Father, will begin to pour on the people around us. And our relationships would grow stronger. And we'd be able to walk hand in hand together, being the people that you call us to be. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.